and his purpose is seeking someone to devour. So we have an adversary. The Bible, Jesus said that in John 10:10, that the thief comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's his purpose. That's his agenda. That's his objective, to steal from us, to kill, and to destroy families. He wants to steal from families, from your finances, from your health, from any dream you have. His agenda is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But bless God, he did not end there. Jesus said, but I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Life to the full, life to overflowing, the good, satisfied life. God wants you to have the abundant life. That is Jesus' objective. Praise God. The reality is that persistent difficulty can make us feel weary, tired. Sometimes we've been Christians for a long time, and I'm telling you, their trials seem unending, and it makes us weary, and it can even discourage us or make us despondent. We lose hope. And sometimes we think that God has abandoned us, and we, you know, we've waited on God and waited on God, and the situation hasn't changed. If it's changed, it's changed just a little bit. Are you with me? And sometimes we feel imprisoned, we feel stuck, we feel trapped. We feel that stuff is not changing, man. I mean, things are not turning around. It's the same old, and we get discouraged. I want to tell you that God has not forgotten you. Amen. Turn to somebody and say, God has not forgotten you. Say, God has not forgotten you. You know, the Bible says he cannot forget you. He can't. God can't forget you. You are on God's mind. The Bible makes this declaration. He is mindful of us. We are on his mind. I'm so glad that the name Kabnafule Bedu is on God's mind. I'm so excited that when I wake up, I'm on God's mind. When I'm walking through the day, I'm on his mind. Oh, bless God, when I go on the 401, I'm on his mind. Amen. And you are on his mind. You are on God's mind. The Bible says in Psalm 8, verse 4, what is mankind that you are mindful of him? Psalm 8, verse 4. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man, that you care for him. Folks, you're on God's mind. Say, I am on God's mind. Say, I am on God's mind. Praise God. Psalm 115, verse 12 says this. The Lord has been mindful of us. He has been mindful of us. You are on God's mind. If you don't get anything else in this sermon, know that you are on God's mind. Say, I am on God's mind. Say, God is thinking about me. Glory to God. We are on God's mind. So he's thinking about us. You know what? He has not forgotten us. Yeah, sometimes your best friends will forget about you. Sometimes your family will forget about you. Even the company you've devoted your life to and worked for, and you've given off your best for 40 years, afterwards when they're letting you go, or when there's a difficulty in this company, they will let you go just like that. And they'll forget about all the service. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Sometimes it happens like that. Your parents forget about you. I remember once when I must have been about maybe 11, 12, or 13, and my mom forgot my birthday. My mom. Dads can forget sometimes. But my mom forgot my birthday. And I remember I was waiting at 8 o'clock in the morning. I was expecting that present. You know what I mean? And I was expecting the usual, the birthday wishes and all the kisses here and there. You know, and I woke at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, nothing. I heard her going about her business. I said, man, they've forgotten my birthday. 11 o'clock, I could stand it no longer. So I went to my mom and said, it's my birthday. Bless God. But God will never forget your birthday. I said, God will never forget your birthday. Hallelujah. You know, you're on God's mind. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 49, verse 15, can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? It says, though she may forget, I will not forget you. A woman who is nursing a child has compassion for that child. And God is saying, look, can a woman, a mother who is nursing that child, forget about the child that is nursing? And then he says, even if the woman forgets, I, God, I will not forget you. Say, God does not forget me. I want you to believe that today. Believe that you're on God's mind. Believe that he has not forgotten you. Believe that he's thinking about you. The Bible tells us, Jeremiah 29, he's thinking good thoughts towards you. Every thought God has towards you are good thoughts. Thoughts of good, not of evil. Thoughts to bless you. Bible says to give you a future and to give you a hope. Glory to God. Say, I have hope in God. Say, I have a future in God. Turn to somebody and say, I have a future in God. Say, I have a hope in God. Say, you have a future in God. You have a hope in God. Notice what he's thinking about. In Psalm 115:12, he says, the Lord has been mindful of us. And look at what he's thinking about. He will bless us. He says he will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, both small and great. Folks, one in this scripture, we are seeing that what is on God's mind is just to bless us. Oh, folks, you have to get this inside of your heart, that when God thinks about you, you are on God's mind, he's thinking, how can I bless Naresh some more? And Naresh will say, oh, I've been blessed already. It's okay, Lord. He said, no, my goodness and my mercy should overflow in your life. You know, he says, my cup runneth over. And he wants you to be so blessed that you can be a blessing, just like he told Abraham. Glory. His on his mind is blessing. How can he empower you to prosper? That's why it says in 3 John 2, beloved, I wish that you prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Or say, God wants to bless me. Hallelujah. So now the thing is this, we're waiting on God to see these manifestations. We're waiting on things to turn around in our lives. We're waiting on God. But the truth is this, God is oftentimes waiting for us. He's waiting for us. He wants us to align ourselves with his will and his purpose so that he can help turn things around for us. God is waiting for us, for example, to humble ourselves so that he can shower grace on us. The Bible says he gives grace to the humble. So he's waiting on us to humble ourselves so he can pour his favor, pour his divine ability and strength upon us. So he's often waiting for us to humble ourselves. You see, if we're in a place of pride, the Bible says he resists the pride. He resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So he's often waiting for us to humble ourselves. He's often waiting for us to ask for help. To ask for help. And it doesn't matter. Sometimes it's only the difficult things in life, like, you know, you have a major decision to make, then you ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Folks, every detail of your life, the Holy Spirit is willing to help you. You're having a bad hair day, bless God. You know, you're having a bad hair day, and you know what? Sometimes I used to have a bad hair day when I had an afro, bless God. You know, one day I'll put up my picture when I had an afro, because I told somebody I had an afro, they did not believe me. But bless God, you may have a bad hair day as a woman, ask the Holy Spirit to help you. You're having a bad day concerning your keys are lost. I know Maureen, for example, she always asks the Holy Spirit when her phone is lost, when her keys are lost, and she finds them. Yeah. Amen. He's willing to help us. Ask for help. He's willing to, when he's waiting for us to ask for help so that he will help us. Praise God. He's waiting on us to call on his name in that time of trouble so that he can save us. He's waiting on us to ask for wisdom when we lack it. Let's say we are in a financial situation and we ask for wisdom from the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, what do I do? He may ask you to go to somebody to give you godly counsel. You ask the Holy Spirit. God is waiting on us. Sometimes we want a financial harvest. He's waiting on us to give a financial seed, to sow or to tithe so that he can give us that financial harvest. He's waiting on us to sometimes believe that what is impossible with man is actually possible with him. God is waiting on us. God is always waiting for us to believe something he has said, to say something he has said, and to do what he has said. God is waiting on us to believe something he has said, a promise or a covenant or a word or a command. Or he's waiting for us to say something. And he's also waiting for us to do. And right now, I'm going to focus on the fact that he wants us to say certain things in our lives to help us to turn it around. around. Praise God. He's waiting for us to say certain right words of faith so he can help us turn our situation completely around. You know, one of the best decisions you can ever make is that of salvation in Christ. Amen? And think about it. The Bible says that there was a sin problem. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. That is the problem. There's a sin problem with mankind. When the Bible says that, but God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. That's the solution. But you know, this was provided for 2,000 years ago, and God is just waiting on us to believe that and to declare that. He's waiting on us. He is waiting for us. The solution is already there. The provision is already there. But he's waiting on us. He's waiting on us. Romans 10:9 says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. He's waiting on us. That one decision completely changes our destination. We were destined for hell, church. But because of that one decision, we believed in our heart the Lord Jesus was raised from the dead, and we confess that he is Lord. Because of that one decision you take, guess what? Your destination now is heaven. You're not going to be in the presence of God. Just by believing that and saying that, now you have a destiny with God. You are going to be in the presence of God. When you're a good ripe age, amen. Or should Christ come again? You are going to be in his presence because of that one decision. It's powerful. But he was waiting on us to believe and to declare. Now, why am I saying this? Why is this important? Because God uses the same principle to turn things around in our lives in so many different ways in terms of the mountains that are in our lives, the insurmountable situations in our lives. He uses the same principle of wanting us to believe something and then to say something and often to also do something. He is waiting on us. You know, we all need to turn things around. I mean, some of us have debts and we want that turned around. If you have debts and you want to turn around, say, I want to turn around. Sometimes we're sick in our bodies and we want to turn around. We want health. Are you with me? Help me out a little bit. I say, are you with me? Yeah. You know, we want certain things turned around. Relationships may have gone sour or may have gone south, and we want it turned around. We want the bitter marriage to become sweet. We want the things that are hard to have an ease to it. We want so many situations to turn it around. And folks, words can help turn your situation around. Words can help turn it around. And God is saying to us today, turn it around with your mouth. Turn it around with your mouth. Now, I know some of you are going, oh, come on, are you realistic? I'm going to show you through the scripture that that's exactly what the Bible teaches. Let's go to the book of James. James chapter 3, verse 3. James chapter 3, verse 3. And I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. It says, we can make a large horse go wherever we want, excuse me, by means of a small bit in its mouth. We can make a large horse go wherever we want by means of a small bit in its mouth. Now, a bit is some sort of contraption that you put in a horse's mouth. And the person who is riding the horse can turn the horse wherever it wants to go. It can actually get the horse to do different commands through that little bit. Notice what he's saying. We, you and I, we can make a large horse. Horses are usually stronger than us. They are faster than us. They can jump higher than us. Are you with me? But he's saying that we can do that. Make a large horse. Go wherever we want. Now, this is James speaking about the power of the tongue. And he's saying that, look, we have the capacity to make a large horse to go wherever we want by a small bit in its mouth. He's talking about words and the mouth and the power of the mouth. Then he goes on in verse 4, and he says this, a small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. Look, listen to that again. A small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. Now, a rudder is a vertical blade at the stern of a ship that can be turned horizontally to change the direction of the ship. And it's small in terms of the size of the ship. But even when there's a storm and the waves are raging, that rudder can direct the ship wherever the pilot chooses to go. What I want you to catch from this is two things. One, we are the ones that can make a large horse go wherever we want by the bit in the mouth. Secondly, a rudder can change a ship wherever the pilot chooses to go. In other words, you can change your situation around with your mouth. You, wherever you want to go, you can declare where you want to go. Are you with me so far? Notice what it says in verse 5. In the same way, so he's talking about the bit in the mouth of a horse. Then he's talking about the small rudder in the ship. He says, in the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches. A tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. What he's saying here, that there's just like a bit in a horse's mouth is a small thing, a rudder on a big ship is a small thing, but it has the power to turn it wherever the pilot wants. He's saying that words are a small thing. It's a tiny thing. In the same way, it has the power to be destructive. To be destructive. Amen. Sometimes we underestimate some words. When you say, I do, for example, your whole life turns around when you stand before the altar and you tell somebody, I'll take you to be my wife in riches, in sickness and in health and so on and so forth. And you say, I do. Suddenly you are joined to somebody else and your whole journey in life changes. What have you said? I do. Just those words. Or sometimes when you say, yes, somebody gives you a job opportunity and you just say, yes, suddenly you're moving on a certain path in terms of your career. Or if you say, no, those words are powerful. They can affect where you're going to go. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's just a word, but it is going to take you to a certain destination. Just like we said yes to Jesus Christ, and our destination is heaven. Our destination is to be in the presence of God. When you say no, it is also a powerful thing. It takes you to the different destination. Words are powerful. If you go into work tomorrow, you look at your boss, and you do this, and you say you're an idiot. Folks, it's going to affect you. You are going to turn around from that office. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So words are powerful. If you look at somebody and say, I will not forgive you ever, that can bind that person for life. And in effect, bind you for life. But if you say, I forgive you, like Stephen did when Paul was there giving accent to the stoning of Stephen, it had an effect. And guess what? I believe that Paul said, forgive them, they know not what they do. I believe that's one of the reasons why Jesus himself met Paul on his way when he was trying to persecute the church. And on the way on the Damascus Road, he met him and he said, I'm going to call you. He said, why are you persecuting me? But I believe that Stephen's prayer had something to do with that. Words are powerful. Turn to somebody and say, words are powerful. So faith-filled words can help turn situations around in your life. Don't underestimate them. Your words, your declarations are like the rudder of a ship, and they have the power to direct you into your God-given destiny. Notice it says, we can actually ask a horse to go wherever we want by the bit. We are the pilots. So you can begin to say things in your life that can steer your life the way you want it to go. And many of us are neglecting the rudder of our words. And God wants us to begin to say some better stuff. Amen. James chapter 3 verse 4. I like what the Message Bible says. It says a small rudder on a huge ship in the hands of a skilled captain sets a course in the face of the strongest winds. No, that's not it. That's okay. James chapter 3, I'll just read it again. Small rudder on a ship, huge ship, in the hands of a skilled captain, sets a course in the face of the strongest wind. So there may be pressures in your life. There may be storms in your life. The winds may be turbulent, and things are all over the place. But the Bible is telling us that a small rudder of your words can actually steer your ship to the right destination. By a skilled captain. So you are the captain of your life in those terms. And the words you say during a time of storm make a difference. Jesus taught the same principle in Mark 11:22, church. He said this, have faith in God. And in Bible says in 23, truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourselves into the sea. Now that's changing the destination of the mountain. That's moving the mountain. That's turning the mountain to go into the sea. He says, go throw yourselves into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that the things that he says will happen. Jesus is saying, it will be done for them. This is powerful stuff. There may be mountains in your life. Are you speaking to your mountains? Are you speaking to your mountains? You see, I believe what God is trying to say, don't underestimate the power of your words. Especially when the words are faith-filled words. When those words are from the scripture. If it's a promise from the word of God and you begin to declare the word of God, that mountain has to go. That's what Jesus said. That's what I beg your pardon. That's what the Lord said to Ezekiel. Prophesy to the mountains. In other words, speak the word of God to the mountains. He said, prophesy to the mountains. Remember, he said, prophesy to the dry bones. Folks, you and I have to learn. It's something we have to learn. What we know already, because we've learned it over 30 years or 40 years or 50 years, is to speak the situation as it is. But that's not what the walk of faith is about. The walk of faith is about speaking what God says in the situation. Amen. So you have to learn to speak. It says, I truly say to you, if anyone, that means anyone means anyone. That means you, it means you, the person beside you. It says anyone who says to this mountain, and notice it says something specific, go throw yourself into the sea and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be done. Now notice this, it's going to be done by God. He is waiting on us to speak to the mountain, and then he will move the mountain. He will do the miracle. But he's waiting on us to speak, to declare, to say something that is in alignment with his word. The tongue, though small, has the power to mess things up or turn things around. You can overcome by your mouth. When you believe the word of God in your heart and you declare it like a rudder, it will chart the course of your life to the destiny that God has for you. The word of God, as when you speak the word of God, it has the backing of God's power because he is the word. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. So when you speak the word and you declare the word in a situation, guess what? God's power and resources back that word to move the mountain. In other words, when we're in a crisis situation, I tell you, it's better to be silent than to say things that will take you in the wrong way. Sometimes you need to go to the word and say, Holy Spirit, give me a promise right now. And find a promise to speak that promise. Because if you're not careful and you just say the negative things, you're causing your life to go in the negative direction. You have to be able to have that. It's something you learn. I want to encourage you to learn to speak to situations. Don't wait till the crisis. Learn to speak to situations now. If you're in debt, begin to speak to your bank accounts. Begin to speak words to your bank account. Begin to ask God for wisdom concerning finances. And folks, he will give you the wisdom. Begin to ask God what to do concerning getting a house or finding a job. Ask God for wisdom. Train yourself now to do that before the crisis hits. I want to give a few examples and we'll close with this. I'll give maybe two or three examples. One powerful example that I like to talk about is the woman with the issue of blood. Here's a woman. She's a woman of means, a woman of substance, and then she falls into sickness. And she's hemorrhaging, she's bleeding. And the Bible tells us that she's bled for 12 long years. And the Bible, you know, when you read the different accounts, it sort of gives a picture of this woman. She had substance, but because of her health, she was looking for a cure. She was going to different doctors, different physicians, and unfortunately, they couldn't help her. The Bible literally says she actually got worse. So here she is, she's spending all her resources on the latest technology of the time, on the latest medicines and the different things that the doctors were recommending so that she'll stop bleeding, but she's actually getting worse. So physically, over 12 years, this is a prolonged period of time. 12 years to be bleeding all the time is a long period. So she's physically unwell. Financially, now she's broke. She's bankrupt financially. And then socially, this woman is hard up too, because when you were bleeding, as a woman, you were considered unclean. So you could not go out to the synagogue if you wanted to pray. You can't go there. You can't go to the temple or anything like that. You can't go out in public. If somebody sits on the same bed as you, that person is considered unclean. So you had to separate yourself from the society. This woman was in a difficult place. And it had persisted for 12 long years. And the Bible tells us in Mark chapter 5, verse 27, she had heard the reports concerning Jesus. Mark 5, 27. She had heard the reports concerning Jesus. And she came up behind him in the throng and touched his garments. Now, I want you to notice something interesting here. The thing that changed this woman's life around is that she touched the hem of Jesus' garments. Okay? But it did not start there. She took a step of faith and touched. Let's just read the scripture. She said, the Bible says, she had heard the reports concerning Jesus. She came up behind him in the throng and touched his garment. For she kept saying, if I only touch his garment, I shall be restored to health. And immediately her flow of blood was dried up at the source. And suddenly she felt in her body that she was healed of a distressing ailment. This is very interesting because what God brought healing was her touching the hem of Jesus' garment. And instantly she was healed. But it did not start there. It started off with her hearing reports about Jesus. Hearing Jesus healing other people who were sick. She heard that Jesus had touched the leper, which was a no-no in those days. You know, lepers were also considered unclean. And one leper said to Jesus, if you're willing, heal me. He says, I will. And he touched that leper. He could have just spoken the word, but he touched the leper. She heard the reports about people who brought a friend, you know, and opened the roof of somebody's home and dropped the friend down, and Jesus healed the crippled man. She heard the reports about Jesus healing, about him being a God, a person of compassion. Glory to God. And what that did is it built faith in the inside of her. It began to give her hope that she could get healed. But notice the other thing she did. Bible says that she kept saying, if I only touch his garment, I shall be restored to health. She kept saying, if I only touch his garment, I shall be restored to health. Folks, this is where we miss out. We start off with our declarations, then we don't see any results, then we let the declarations dry up. But this woman kept saying. In other words, she was declaring, if I only touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. If I only touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. If I only touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. She kept declaring this. I don't know how many times, but this suggests she kept on saying it. And she had to break a lot of laws to get to Jesus. Because it was unlawful for her to go into a crowd, but she was able to go. She wanted a miracle so bad that she knew it was only the grace of God that was going to get her that miracle. Glory to God. So even though Jesus was on his way to heal somebody else, she was persistent in her faith. And she pressed through that crowd and she touched the hem of his garment, and instantly virtue left Jesus. She got her healing suddenly and instantly, and Jesus felt it. Because she touched Jesus by faith. Folks, she heard what Jesus had done, and then she said, she declared, and what happened? Her health turned around by what she said. By what she said. You see, she could have said, oh no, I've been sick for 12 years. What is happening to me? And she could have kept on saying, I don't know what's happening. I'm not seeing any manifestation. I've been sick for 12 years. And that would be her declaration, and that would be what she's saying. But what she said was, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. I'll be restored to health. That changed her destiny. In terms of her physical health. Powerful stuff. Sometimes some of us have been praying for our loved ones for salvation. And we pray 10 years, 15 years, and folks, they're getting worse. They're even more skeptical. But I'm here to tell you that you got to be persistent. Persistent. You got to be persistent. Keep believing for their salvation. Let them, they may curse you, they may make fun of you. Keep believing for their salvation. Remember, God himself had to look for a man, Moses, to go to Pharaoh. In fact, sometimes I wonder, Lord, why did you have to even ask Moses to go to Pharaoh? Because why couldn't you just blow on Egypt and just get your people out? But he needed somebody. And he needed somebody to declare something. God sent Moses to Pharaoh and said, let my people go so that they will worship me. And folks, it was not the first time that Pharaoh let him go. Pharaoh said no. Basically, he said no. The first time that Moses said that, Pharaoh said no, and he made it even more difficult for the Israelites. And then God brought a plague. And then Moses had to go back to Pharaoh and said, this is what the Lord God says, let my people go that they'll worship me. And he basically said, no. 10 times he had to keep going back. What I'm saying is that we have to be persistent when we're praying for our loved ones. Be persistent in asking God for deliverance. Be persistent. Be persistent. Keep on saying what is the word of God or the promise of God, and it will come to pass in your life. Can I hear a good amen? Amen. She kept saying, keep on saying that you're blessed. Keep on saying that you're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Keep on saying that you have the wisdom of God, because the Bible says, if we ask, he will give liberally. Keep on declaring what God has said in his word. Can I hear a good amen? Amen. Remember when Jesus declared to the wind and the sea, my Bible says Jesus rebuked the wind and spoke to the sea. This is really interesting. Mark chapter 4, verse 39. You know, Jesus is going out to the other side. He told his disciples, let's go to the other side. And so they go, and everything is fine. And then as they are going to the other side in the boat, suddenly there's turbulence and there's wind and there's a storm. And the Bible says the sea is raging, and Jesus is asleep. He's asleep at the stern of the boat. And basically, he's on a cushion. He's fast asleep. And all the disciples who are professional fishermen are terrified, you know. And then they're at their wit's end. They don't know what to do. And then they start, you know, they go wake him up. You know, it says that he arose and he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace be still, and the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But it's interesting because the Bible tells us in verse 38, he was in the stern asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Okay? So basically I say, don't you care that we are perishing? And then Jesus gets up, and the Bible says he arose, he rebuked the wind and he said to the sea, peace be still. I want you to notice something interesting here. So there's the waves are turbulent, and there's a raging storm going on, and the boat is turning up, you know, it's really bad, and they're getting flooded, and the professional fishermen think they're going to drown. It's a bad situation. What does Jesus do? First, he rebukes the wind. Say the wind. You and I have to learn that we are not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. That's why the Bible says all of us have to put on the full armor of God. Praying in the spirit, taking the sword of the spirit. Folks, this is a spiritual world. It's a spiritual world. Many times we just attack people, or we just look at the physical, and no. Know that there is a spirit realm. And ask God for wisdom how to pray. That's why praying in the Holy Ghost is so important. And yet most of the church, even though they have the gifts, they don't use it. Jesus spoke to the wind. You can't see the wind. We have to speak to the spirit realm first. Learn to declare first there. And the Bible says after that, he spoke to the sea. Do you notice what it says? Let's just read that again. The Bible says, he rose and rebuked the wind, and he spoke to the sea. He said to the sea, he rebuked the wind, and he said to the sea, peace be still. So he declared to the sea after he had rebuked the wind. Oh, you want to catch that. You want to catch that in your spirit. It's important to recognize that sometimes we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, so we have to deal with some of the things that are spiritual. You have to do some binding, folks. I said you have to do some binding. You have to do some loosening as well. And you have to speak to situations to be still, to be calm. Glory to God. Most of us tend to react like the disciples. Lord, don't you care that I'm in this situation for such a long time? Don't you care, Lord? And what that is really saying is that we're beginning to doubt the love of God. And when we doubt the love of God, we cannot make positive declarations of faith. You have to believe that no matter what you're going through, God is good. And no matter what is going through, the Bible says that we know that in all things, God works for the good of those that love him. Folks, you have to believe it. It doesn't matter what storms you're going through. You have to believe that somehow God is at work in your life for your good. You have to believe it. And the only way you believe that is when you know that his love for you is unqualified and his love for you is consistent. Oh, church, I want you to believe that in your heart today. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, unfortunately, many of us Christians, we're just like that, like the disciples. We don't use the rudder of our ship. I believe Jesus, when Jesus said to the disciples, where is your faith? I believe Jesus wanted them to speak to them, to rebuke the wind. He wanted them to speak to the sea. So he said, where's your faith? Because he was asleep. In other words, he knew that they would handle it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You know, and we're unfortunately like that, the disciples. We refuse to use the rudder of our ship to our advantage, the words in our mouth to our advantage. Never doubt the love of God. If you doubt the love of God, you're not going to be able to speak words of faith. And the bottom line is that, remember that God loves you, know what? Remember that you're on his mind. Remember that he's thinking of how to bless you. He's thinking of how to make you advance, amen, in his purpose and in his will. And use some powerful words of faith. Hallelujah. So we're going to do that. We're going to do that. I don't know where you're at. I don't know what circumstances you're in. But we're going to declare a few things that are based on the scripture. A few things that are based on scripture. I want you to learn to do this. Folks, don't just do it today. Try and discipline yourself to find some scriptures to be declaring on a regular basis. Try and do that. You know, the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 37 and 38, that we know that in all things we are more than conquerors. And it says in verse 37, I am persuaded that neither death nor life, angels or principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. I want us to begin to realize this, that you are more than a conqueror in all things. I want you to say, I am more than a conqueror. Say, in all things, I am more than a conqueror. Say, in all things, I am more than a conqueror. Turn to someone and say, in all things, I am more than a conqueror. You are more than a conqueror. I want you to declare, nothing can separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Say, nothing, nothing, nothing can separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Say, I am God's beloved. I'm his favorite one. God is on my mind. And I'm on God's mind. Say, he is mindful of me. God has not forgotten me. Oh, church, I want you to begin to just declare these things on a regular basis. Psalm 138 says that though we are surrounded by trouble, you know, we will not be afraid because he will protect us from dangers. And his Bible says, the Lord will work out his plans for me. I want you to say, the Lord will work out his plans for my life. The Lord will work out his plans for my life. God is faithful and he will do it. God will work out his plans to prosper me, not to harm me. He wants to give me a future. He wants to give me a hope. He wants to bless me. Say, I am certain that God who began a good work inside of me will continue this work and complete it in Jesus' name. Say, God will fulfill his purpose in my life. Now, I want you to stand up right now in the name of Jesus and say, the Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? God is with me. He's not against me. Say, God is for me. He's not against me. Say, God is in me. The greater one is in me. I have greatness inside of me because the greater one is inside of me. Say, I overcome even by my faith. I have victory because Christ is the victory. I have victory over every foe, over every situation. I'm turning it around. Say, I am blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Say, I belong to Christ. I'm Abraham's seed. I'm an heir according to promise. The same promise God gave to Abraham belongs to me. The same promise God gave to Abraham belongs to me. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the country. I'm blessed going out. I'm blessed going in. My head is crowned with blessing. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich and added no sorrow. I am blessed because of Jesus. His divine power has given to me all things that pertain to life and godliness. Say, I am blessed. I am so blessed because of Jesus. Say, I am going through the valley of the shadow of death. I am going through it. I will fear no evil because God is with me. Say, his goodness and his mercy. Say, his favor surrounds me this day and all the days of my life. Give a shout to the Lord right now. Hallelujah. Folks, we can turn it around with our mouths. The exercise is for you. You got to get some scriptures. If you like, you can go back onto the website, listen to what I just said, and say those things again. The exercise is what I can't do. Those in leadership or those who are pastoring over you have a certain influence. But you are the one that can change things around with your mouth. It's you. I said it's you. So you got to find some scriptures, find some promises, and then simplify it and speak it out. Don't underestimate it. It's powerful stuff. And you begin to see things turn around, turn around, turn around, turn around, turn around. And before you realize it, you were totally in debt, and then suddenly you're in a place of abundance. And God will show you step by step what to do. Step by step what to do. You may be going through a tough, somebody here is going through a tough time in their marriage. It's not easy. It's difficult. You've prayed and prayed and prayed some more. God is saying, begin to bless your partner. Affirm your partner. Begin to call out the things you want to see in your partner. In the name of Jesus. Don't be over religious about it. Just begin to call out what you desire in your home. If it is peace in your home, begin to say, speak peace to your home. Speak joy to come forth in your home. Speak righteousness to come inside of your home. I believe that's a word for somebody. Turn it around with your mouth. Turn it around with your mouth. Speak to your children. Declare they are mighty in the land, no matter what. Doesn't matter where they're at. Say, you are mighty in the Lord. Say, you have a destiny with God. You declare that God will fulfill that which concerns them. Say that to your own life. Say, God will fulfill that which concerns me. Say these things out. Concerning health, speak it out. Say, I know what it's like. You're feeling ill. Your body is ill and you're weak or whatever it is. But just speak forth what the Word of God says. Just speak it out. By his stripes, I was healed. You're not lying. You are declaring truth. The fact is you may be sick in your body, but declare truth because truth overrides facts. Say, by his stripes, I was healed. And say it over and over and over again. And see how God will turn it around. I want to recommend coming tonight to the healing school. Folks, I believe God wants us to be a house where his healing virtue flows freely in us and through us. And one way is to have teaching concerning healing. So we began to do this too. We're going to do this twice every month. We did that the 1st of October, and this is the second evening we're doing it. Come and just sit under the teaching concerning healing. It will bless you. Don't wait to be in that crisis situation. We want to prevent you from getting into a crisis situation. Let healing be flowing in you now. Bible says that, beloved, I would that you be in health. That he didn't pray that, oh Lord, heal them. He wants you to be in health. And one of the ways is know the healing words and to hear the scriptures concerning healing so that you have faith inside of you concerning your healing and the fact that it's been purchased by Jesus. I want to encourage you, come. It's just an hour. Forget about the baseball or hockey or whatever. Come and just receive teaching on healing. Pastor Bob is bringing a good word today. Last time we had the healing school, it was really, really good. And then there's ministry of healing. Our goal is to be able to walk in health and then to be vessels to communicate that to other people as well. Amen? But I encourage you, your homework is find one or two scripture promises and begin to meditate on them. Make it easy for you, based on that, to declare it. And I'm telling you, God wants us to turn situations around with our mouth. Let us pray. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus that you love us so much. Your word says you know the plans you have for us, plans of good and not of evil, plans to give us a future, plans to give us a hope. Your word says very clearly that you are mindful of us, each one of us. You know us by name, and you're thinking about us, thoughts of good, not of evil, thoughts to give us a future and to give us a hope. Thank you. Your will for us is that we prosper in all things and be in health, even as our soul prospers. So, Father, today I just thank you for your beloved. I know you gave me this word to speak to them, to remind many people, to just keep declaring the promises and the positive things you want in our lives so that our situations would turn around. You know where everybody is at. Father, you know where every one of us, where we are at. I just pray in the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, that you give the appropriate scriptures or the declarations for your people to begin to speak words of faith, to turn things around in their lives, in their marriages, in their homes, in their relationships, in their finances, in their careers, in their workplaces. In Jesus' name. For about 30 seconds, I just want us to have that Selah moment. Just for 30 seconds. Where we're just pondering to see what God will say to us as individuals. Hallelujah. Father, we bless you. Just bless him right now. Just thank him. Just honor him. Glory to God. Thank him right now. If you need prayer, we'll be happy to pray with you in the front. Otherwise, I want you to just bring up the declarations that we have. Dennis, the declaration. And we'll say that together. That's one of the reasons why we always try to declare things at the end of the service. Because we want to have the habit of declaring positive things, and our whole and our desires, our hope is that these things will be memorized. You memorize it, and you can say them not only on a Sunday, but to your family, to yourself. But let's just read that together. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Let's say that again. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. So turn to somebody and look them eyeball to eyeball. And let's say it together. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. One more time. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Let's give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah.